An operation on his eye, and he should be seen 20/20. That is amazing. That is so great. And then he did want me just to announce this, and we'll put this on our website as well, so that way you guys can go there and see it. But Lifeline Colorado, the place Rob works for, is going to do a back to school bash where they'll be giving out free school supplies, free family resources, we'll have free family resource booths. And then also they have a DJ, dancing, food, and more. And this will be Saturday, August 19th. And the address and the time is going to be 12 p.m. To 4 p.m. It's going to be pretty much on 13th of Bayard, or west of Bayard. But like I said, we're going to put it on the website so you guys can actually have the whole address for you, so you guys can be able to go there and find out where it's at. Hey, go get it. Go get you guys a backpack or whatever you need for the school year. You guys excited about school starting?
No.
Yes.
Well, I heard a mixture. No. I feel like some parents are like, yeah, and then the kids are like, no. But that's all right. You know what? We also just want to show a couple more pictures of this lovely family. The Vasquez had a family reunion. They had more sparks. And there's a couple of the matriarchs and the patriarchs, and we just love this family, so we wanted to show a couple of pictures of them at the park. And, there's no getting more pictures, but yeah, you know, we'll put more up there. But you know, that's just that is just one of those wonderful things that we're doing life together. So we always want to, you know, honor the Lord for what He's doing in each other's lives. Speaking of somebody to honor, Akina graduated, so we wanted to just congratulate her one more time. That's a proud grandma right there. I mean, remember when she was holding her as a little kid right there? This is when I met her, was when she was about this age, and then she was with her late buddy right there, Ray, our brother Ray. So, I mean, you know, if you see her walking in or you see your grandma, let her know that, you know, just we're proud of Akina and her accomplishments in graduating. That's not easy to graduate. Right, I got my GED, good enough degree, you know what I mean? But so for all those who got their diploma, I'm just like, so I'm super proud of you guys. And you know, if you got, I know there's some other kids graduating, so please send the pictures, and we'll love to honor your young ones. There's pictures from last week. Look at that, a lovely pastor right there, Mike, with Jack and Sally. And look at these two young ladies. And I want to show this picture because, like, look at that. You're not here, you're missing that. You know, that's all I'm saying. And then we're hoping to see your mom, Cynthia, again. That was so wonderful seeing her last week. And then also we want to report a praise to the Lord. Hope is still going through some difficult times, but the Lord blessed her in a tremendous way. So we just wanted to thank you for that as well. Getting into some prayer requests. We're still praying for our sister, Raquel. But you know what, she didn't even tell me the other day because she probably was embarrassed I was going to tell her, but her birthday was this last week on the 26th. Yay. So, happy birthday, Raquel. Where are you?
She's in there.
Hiding.
Yeah.
She's in there.
Yeah. Hi, there she is. Hey, everybody. Say everyone, say happy birthday to you. Well, it's her birthday, and we're also going to... Oh, I come out there. You were literally just out here singing everybody. But you know what? We're also continuing to pray for you.
Yes, you are.
And your knee, she tore her meniscus. The meniscus. And her pain is a little bit less, but she's still in pain. But look, we're just thankful to the Lord that who she is, leading us in worship every Sunday, and leading the worship team every Wednesday. So we praise you, Doctor. And happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
We're also still continuing to pray for our brother, Gilbert. As he's, he's already seen the doctor, so we're going to have to find out. Yeah, but this is past the 22nd, so he saw the doctor yesterday. So we're going to have to ask him about the update and what's going on.
Pastor Mike, I have a wrong date now. It's Monday, tomorrow.
It's Monday. That's all right. So then pray for him that tomorrow when he goes into the doctors, that the doctors have a good plan and everything is going to be good for our man Gilbert. Amen?
Amen.
All right. And then we're still continuing to lift up Gianna Tover's grandfather, who has been diagnosed with cancer. We will continue to lift him up and just we're asking for a miracle. So we know probably somebody or directly has been affected by cancer. So let's pray for anybody being affected by that, but let's really be intentional about praying for this young lady's grandfather. And we're gonna still continue to pray for all of his family, especially her daughter who is battling and struggling against alcohol. We know 3 weeks ago, our sister Jenna, who we were praying for, went home to be with the Lord. Hope wanted me to let you guys know when the services will be held. They'll be held the 28th of this month at 10 a.m. Right here in Reed Ridge at 3900 Pierce Street. She says if anybody feels led to go or to even go with Hope, she would be grateful to just get with her, talk to her, and she will let you know the details. And we're also continuing to lift up our brother Rick Messes as he's fighting his battle with cancer. But we know every fight is winnable if God's in your corner. Amen? Because our God is victorious. We have victory in Him. And then you know what? This has just been in my heart as well. Us as a church, I'm always stressing to everybody I come in contact with that we need to be intentional. And I know some of you guys come from a different neighborhood, you know what I mean? Like I live in Thornton, right? But I know this, where our church is and this neighborhood in Lakewood. I'm here all week, every weekend, and it's heartbreaking to see. I grew up in this neighborhood, what's happening here. So I want as a church body to intentionally bring this neighborhood, the neighborhood of Iber, and the city of Lakewood before the Lord, and just ask Him to do an amazing thing. God willing, He uses us to do that amazing thing, but we really need to be intentional about praying for this neighborhood and the people, all that they are going through. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so we're going to take all those things before the Lord. You guys go, bow your heads and open your hearts. Lord Jesus, Father God of heaven and earth, Lord, we come to You expectantly, knowing You are a good God, that You will never fail us. Lord, we lift up our worship leader to You, Raquel. She has torn a meniscus, and we, a lot of us don't know what that pain is, Lord. But we know pain, and pain is just so hard to get through when it's daily. Lord, we are thankful for her spirit and her strength, but we ask for more strength, Lord. We ask for more healing. Lord, come and intervene in her life in a great way where she is able to walk quickly, faster, and just ready to dance around, Lord, for joy for You. Lord, we lift up our brother Gilbert, who has the doctor's appointment tomorrow, Lord. We pray that it's a good appointment. That when they go in there, there's minimal intervening that the doctors will have to do. And that the doctors have a plan for him to get better. Lord, for Gianna's grandfather, who is battling this fight with cancer, Lord, we pray that he's able to have strength to fight this horrible disease, Lord. Lord, we know You can, if You are willing, just take cancer away from him. Lord, if it's by means of a miracle or if it's by means of Your providential power and using medicine, Lord, whatever way, we just ask for healing so he could see his granddaughter Gianna grow up, Lord. Lord, we pray for our brother Rick and his battle against cancer. Lord, we pray for just everybody, all the unspoken prayers, for those struggling with alcohol like our sister's daughter, For those who are afflicted in this neighborhood, Lord, who think they have no worth, who are just struggling to get by. Lord, we know what that feels like, so we want to intervene and intercede on their behalf and just ask for more blessings, Lord. More willingness to not look away, but to look towards each other, to look towards You, most importantly. Lord, help this little building, this little hub of hope, shine in this dark area so that way people know what You are doing here, Lord. For You are so alive and so good and so great. You just want to do great things for all people who are willing to bow a knee and to surrender their lives to You, Lord. Lord, we give this neighborhood to You. We give this city to You, Lord. We give this state. We give everything that is of us, Lord, to You because You gave it all to us first. In Your name, Jesus, we pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
Just a reminder, if it's your first time here, please fill out a first touch card. Flip it over. If you've been here for a while, you know that you could.
Your
card. Oh, my card. Yeah, don't worry. We'll figure that one out. If you guys can, that's going to bother me. Like, yeah, I know. Either way, fill out your prayer request. Please turn off your cell phones. And if you guys can, release the teenagers right before the service starts. So that way they could go and be blessed by the game plan that Jack and Colleen have. And then also this reminder, if you guys can, feel free to come on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. We are doing a new format. We are going to be doing Bible studies. And I think these last 2 weeks, I think they've been blessed. What do you guys think? They haven't only been blessed, but they've been a blast. You know what I mean? And it's so cool because, I mean, here we are just coming together to worship and praise the Lord and just digging in deeper and just trying to find out more about what's going on, not only in our lives, but what the Scripture is trying to reveal to us. So please join us 6 p.m. It's right downstairs in Fellowship Hall. And use this time to get through a drink. It was cool earlier. So get you some waters and cold waters. Use the restroom. Say hi to how you doing. Take your kids to the nursery. They do have to be checked in by an adult or a guardian. And we'll see you back in 10. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I didn't touch the cord. I don't know what I did.
Thank you, Jesus. some people to pass this plastic out. I just would like to call our attention to the building that we have, right? And two bills, right? And so this money that we give goes to help pay the cost of the building, right? We are the temple of Christ, our bodies, but we meet in this building, right? So everything that you give goes to promote the building, right? And so we need this building, or else we'll be sitting outside in the park somewhere, which is not a safe thing anywhere. So you see those guys with the signs, right? Anything helps, right? Anything helps. So, you know, and so just think about it, right? And so we come and we worship, and we give our money to support the building, right? And plus, there's a bonus. Jesus says he'll bless you in the end, too. So it's a double. And so, Heavenly Father, Lord God, I pray right now that by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would touch our souls, touch our hearts, Lord God, that we wouldn't be stingy with our money, that we believe that you will help us make the means to pay our bills when we give to you, Lord. And I pray this in the name of Jesus, and be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
Has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quites, with all the never getting rights. But it turns out that I'm one of you looking for all this time, 'cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
amazing. How's everybody doing? You guys still with me? It's a little warm, I know, but I think it's pretty cool. You know what's really cool is you guys. You guys are cool. Well, you guys don't get an amen for that. I thought y'all were pretty cool. Here y'all looking at me, they're like, I'm cool, but you ain't cool. That's what's going on, man. That's what my niece and nephew always tell me. They're quick to remind me, like, you ain't that cool, uncle. I'm like, one day, you'll be like me, and you won't be cool me. can we give a little bit of encouragement for our sister Hope? She's going to bless us by reading our scripture today. Can we give her a round of applause?
The Eternal Covenant of Peace, Chapter 54, 1 through 17. Sing, O barren one who did not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud. You who have not been in labor, for the children of the one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitation be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes, for you will spread abroad to the right and to the left. And your offspring will possess the nations, and will people the desolate cities. Fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced. For you will forget the shame of your youth, and the reproach of your widowhood you will remember no more. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. And the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer. The God of the whole earth, he is called. For the Lord has called you like a wife, deserted and grieved in spirit, like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says your God. For a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing anger for a moment, I hid my face from you. But with everlasting love, I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. This is like the days of Noah to me, as I swore that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth. So I have sworn that I will not be angry with you. I will not rebuke you, for the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you. And my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on me. O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not confronted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony and lay your foundations with sapphire. I will make your pinnacles of agate, your gates of carbuncles, and all your wall of precious stones. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. In righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near you. If anyone stirs up strife, it is not from me. Whoever stirs up strife with you shall fall because of you. Behold, I have created the smite who blows the fire of coals and produce a weapon for its purpose. I have also created the ravager to destroy. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed, and you shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord.
Well, let's see how much technology is going to bless us today. The Lord already blessed me, so I ain't even worried about it. Amen? Amen. Yeah, it'd be like, And when it works, it's a blessing. When it doesn't, we're still blessed by it. I ain't on a trip, yeah. Right? But thank you so much for reading for us, Hope. I'm just excited to have you guys. If you've been with us for this last year, we've been in the book of Isaiah. And in the theme of the book of Isaiah, we believe as a church is to be rebuked, to be reproved, so that way we can be restored. And in here, we get to hear a bit of that promise of restoration, that eternal promise that God is offering. And when we found out last week what was going on is there was this fulfillment of the Messiah coming. And we called the title of last week's message, The Startling Silent Servant. Because like I said, it was just so amazing to me, like here where most people, yeah, I know if I was in Jesus' shoes, would have been arguing or trying to make a plea of why I didn't deserve what I was going through. But instead, he remained silent so that way his actions could speak louder than anything throughout history. Because it changed the course of human history when he decided to go and jump on that cross, but be placed on that cross, so that way we can be forgiven. Because he was our king, he was our humbling, exalted king, and yet he said, I'm going to bring you guys salvation. I'm going to bring the kingdom to you. And it was just such an amazing time, and I was so blessed to be able to preach it. Like I said, Isaiah 53, I think I could have sat there and talked a whole lot longer because there's just so much to that just section of scripture. I was actually thinking with my brother Brian earlier where he said that scripture helped lead him to Christ. We know it was the Holy Spirit using that scripture, but it was just one of those things when he read that story, it was confounding to just see what was going on, to read it and just to know that, wow, why would somebody so powerful and so amazing do that for little old me? And yet here he says, was because you were wonderfully and fearfully made. Yeah. You found before the foundations of the world, I knew you. He knew and called you. So that way one day you will come and be with him. And so and it kind of abruptly changes from that setting to the next one. Like if you have the ESV, the header is the eternal covenant peace. This peace that you're going to have for eternity. And it goes from, this is what we got to do. This is what's going to happen. And while they're reading it, you're confounded. And then Isaiah breaks into a song. Like, Isaiah, he's the prophet of songs. And I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but we've done plenty of amount of songs that Isaiah has sang praising the Lord. I think in all in the book of Isaiah, there's like 30 of them. And it is because he is just overwhelmed by the goodness of God. And yet, he's overwhelmed by the goodness of God, and what's going on is he's preaching, you know, from the first beginning part of our series and through the book of Isaiah. What is he preaching? He's preaching chastisement. He's preaching judgment. He's preaching things that people need to know. Why so you get into this and say, but there's good news. I give you the bad news, but there's good news. Yeah. And now he's just thinking of that good news, and he's just like, shh. And not only that, but God promises to give you peace and peace eternal. Amen. And today's message I titled Barrenness into Fruitfulness. Before I get any further, I'd be foolish of me to try to go forward without asking the Lord to bless this time. So you guys can bow your heads and open your hearts. Let's ask the Lord to bless this moment. Lord Jesus, we give this moment to you. Lord, use me, speak through me, Lord. Lord, help us to open not only our ears but our hearts, so we can not only be hearers of the word, but doers as well. Lord, your servants are listening. And all this we speak and pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So barrenness into fruitfulness. So I love commentary. One of my buddy's heroes, Pastor Mike Spurgeon. Yeah, never heard Charles Spurgeon, Prince of Preachers, right? I read a little commentary, and he starts off the commentary about first one of this section of scripture like this. It says, in the Western clime, we do not know all the misery which was felt by Eastern women who were childless. They were looked down upon and despised, yet here God bids them sing. And dear friends, if you and I feel as if our hearts have become barren so that we cannot think of God or raise our thoughts towards Him as we would desire, if we feel that we have become useless, and for that reason our spirit is greatly depressed, let us give heed to this sweet, this charming exhortation of Jehovah. Sing, O barren soul, break forth into singing and cry aloud, for God can turn our barrenness into fruitfulness and make us rejoice, make us to rejoice exceedingly before Him. So I read that and I was like, that's my title. Barrenness into fruitfulness. I don't know what it's like for a woman who is barren, but I know what it's like to feel empty and desolate. I know what it's like to be in a moment in my life where I just feel like I'm empty. For many years of my life, I spent a good amount of time trying to fill that emptiness with drugs, alcohol, sex, anything I could get my hands on that would give me a temporary relief of pleasure. And all it did was left me feeling more empty, more barren. But through that barrenness, and when I hit rock bottom, that's when God lifted me up and He said, I got something more for you. And when I surrendered my life over to Christ, that's when all of a sudden that emptiness didn't only get filled up, but it started overflowing. And I think that's why Isaiah just wants to sing. And that's why he says it, because he's like, you may be barren at this moment, but man, when God comes in and you let Him intervene, it's going to be so full. It's going to fill you up so much that you're going to overflow to the person next to you and to that person next to them, that before you know it, people around you are going to catch this amazing joy that you have because of what God is doing in your life. And I love it. That's why when he starts, I don't know why he does not like that slide, but when it starts, sing, O barren one who did not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud, for you who have not been in labor, for the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. I had to see, I don't know, that slide for some reason does not like that slide. That's kind of funny. I just kind of think it's funny. But like, you know, like and they use like analogies, right? Right in the Bible to kind of so we can get a picture. Because it, like, just like all humans, for the most part, we need something to kind of equate it with so that way we can understand it more. And here he is equated to women who were barren, who were not able to have kids, because in the time that Israel was doing this thing, and they were sinning against the Lord, they ended up what? They ended up having to go and get punished, exiled to getting taken by the Babylons, right? Like, I mean, Egypt before that. And God saying, hey, just like that woman that once felt that shame and felt like she was worth nothing because of her barrenness, I'm going to bless it to where you're not only going to be able to have kids, but you're going to have kids abundantly. I don't know if you guys ever remember the story of Hannah, right? And Naomi, here she, it was just heartbreaking. And I think still today, even though culture will try to say, well, women are better to go pursue the careers and not have kids, I would say right now, I have seen my sister, and I see all my sisters, that four of them, and their kids have blessed their lives tremendously. You know, there is something about kids that brings just fruit. It changes your aspect. Not saying there's nothing wrong if you don't have kids, but God wants you to know, it's like, hey, if they could understand what somebody would feel like, look at that lady who is heartbroken because she can't procreate, she can't have a kid. And she's gonna go from sadness and heartbreak to singing, to overjoy. What a contrast, going from one to the other. And like I said, we can't relate to, maybe some of you can, but you know, I can see that contrast because I know I've been in that dark and then in the light. Like you've all probably been in a place where it was just so depressing. And you might even be in that place right now, but God's saying, after you get out of there, you're going to be more than what you ever expected. Yes. You're going to have more than you could ever expect. You're going to have life and life to the fullest. Thank you, And he says, you should even prepare for this. I like that, because he says, don't worry about it in this moment, because think of, keep your eyes on to heaven and all things will be added unto you. Keep in mind what's going to happen. Because if I'm promising you this is going to happen, then you should just prepare almost as if it already did. That's why we say things in the church like, we are no longer victims, we are what? Victors.
Yes.
Because a lot of people look at the church and be like, oh, I see a lot of you guys, and what's going on? You guys don't seem like you have victory. And we look at them like, on the contrary, I have victory because of what my God did. I have victory in Him, amen? Amen. So I could get ready and live a life of victory, even amidst being broken, church. I understand that life is hard. God understands that life is hard, but He's saying, even though it's hard, I'm with you, and I'll always be with you. So count it as done. Count it as it's already happened. Because it has. He's already defeated death. We just sang a song, death, where is your sting? It ain't got a sting no more. Why? Because death just brings life. And life eternal. Let's talk about that eternal peace. Right? He gets into verse 2. He says, enlarge the place of your tent. And let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stay. Although he said, don't only make room for a bigger tent. He says, don't even be limited by what your imagination or what your mind could even fathom. He's saying, like, as big as you could think you're going to make your tent, it's bigger. Yeah. And as much as you could imagine heaven to be, it's better. He said, no matter what you think it is, keep on thinking more, because it is even greater than that.
Yes.
So he's saying, get ready for it. Get ready for it, because you will, like, and he's talking to Israel as if they're his wife, right? They're the wife that was there, and it was the wife that was the shame. And he's just saying this because he wants to say, this is how much I love you. I choose you. That's one thing, right? Like, you don't choose your sister or your brother, but you choose your wife. You choose your husband. You made a choice that I'm going to be one with that person. And God's saying, I chose you, even though you're broken, even though you cheated on me, even though you did all these things, I chose you, and now that I chose you, and you had to suffer through what you're doing, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless you to the fullest, right? He says, for you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. He's kind of alluding to that promise. I don't know if you guys remember that promise he made to Abraham so many years ago, right? In this time, this is 700 years before this, when the prophecy was written, before Jesus even came. Prior to that, what was that, like 1,300 years when he was promising Abraham? Well, not that many years, it's like 300. But did you know, like, there's this crazy thing where he's promising Abraham that, man, you're going to have offspring that should be like the dust of the earth. I don't know, we live in an old building. Y'all know what dust is. It's everywhere. Hey, we're working on it. We get a little. Actually, you guys have noticed there's less dust because we got a new cleaning crew, and they do amazing. You know, I'm just saying, like, thank you, Jesus, for the new cleaning crew. but you know what I mean? Like, dust, it's everywhere. He said, your people are going to be everywhere. And at this moment, they need to hear this. Because what's going on is only a handful of them, a remnant, is going to return to Jerusalem when Cyrus releases them. When Persia, when the king of Persian, the Persian king says, guys, go ahead and go and rebuild your kingdom. Go ahead and go back to Jerusalem. It says there's only but a remnant, a handful. They go in great in number, and now they're looking around and they're like, where's everybody at? Where's Mashiach? You know, where's Israel? Where are all these people that we used to know? Because it says a lot of them decided to just stay where they're at. A lot of them didn't want to return to Jerusalem. But those who wanted to remain faithful to God, they said, we're going. We're going, but they need some encouragement. They need to remember not only in the moment what they're seeing, but what's promised to them in the far off. Like, I think that's relevant to us, because I need to know that this isn't all that there is. And you know what? My life is good. I ain't gonna complain. I am blessed beyond measure. But God has so much more for me, especially when I get to go home to be with Him. It's the peace that passes understanding. Yes, I may have peace in this time and in this moment, but it will never be like the peace that I'll achieve or that I'll have when I get to be with my Maker. I mean, and he just wants us to just count on it. Abraham, I mean, he had one son. And he's like, how is this one going to turn into the dust, the numbers of the dust? But he had faith. He just said, it's not for me to see in this moment, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Like people's generational curses, we are about changing those things in this church. Yes. But it may not happen in our generation. But we know we can set the foundations. The foundation is Christ. And you know, next generation, they're going to be better. Next generation is going to be better. Because we don't need to do everything in one night. I get told that all the time. I have wise counsel always saying, Mike, you can't get it all done at once. But you just do the work step by step. And you keep your eyes unto heaven. And it says, all things will be added unto you. Everything. In Isaiah 14, 1 through 2, I wanted to bring this back up because he mentioned this. He already promises them. Here Isaiah is reminding them, but he's already told them before when he said, for the Lord will have compassion on Jacob and will again choose Israel and will set them in their own land. And sojourners will join them and will attach themselves to the house of Jacob. And the peoples will take them and bring them to their place. And the house of Israel will possess them in the Lord's land as male and female slaves. They will take captive those who were their captors and rule over those who oppressed them. He already promised them years ago. God's going to deliver you guys. God's going to free them. And then as they're getting freed, what happens? Well, I thought it was going to be more. Well, you should just be excited that you're free. Like, why are you worried about this and that? I mean, that's the human heart, though, right? Like, God, just, man, I'm hungry. Just give me something to eat. And then all of a sudden, he gives you Brussels sprouts. Lord, I really wanted something else, you know? Like, why does my neighbor get pizza and I get Brussels sprouts? What's up with that? I don't know. I think I like, but I've only tried them once, you know? But, you know, because they just seem to look at them. But you know the idea, right? Is you're not content with what God wants to give you. But I'm telling you right now, it is blessed. You are so blessed when all of a sudden you can start seeing that, like, man, what if it's Brussels sprouts or if it's corn, tortillas, and not flour. I like flour tortillas. But even if it's not exactly what you want or how you wanted it, God's still blessing you in that moment. God's still blessing you. God's still giving you something that you didn't have. God still is showing you what? Compassion. I don't know about you guys, but when I was reading the chapter, that's what I keep hearing is, we have a compassionate God. Our God is passionate about who we are. Like he shows us compassion. Like he sees us broken and he doesn't just look the other way. And I don't know if you're guilty of it. I know I'm guilty of that. I see somebody struggling and I look the other way. Because why I have things going on in my life that I'm more worried about. And God's saying, man, you should have helped that guy or helped that lady. Why did you look away? And we're human. We got so much going on already. Like, right? Like, and one of the biggest arbitrators of it, I think, is fear. Like, I'm scared to get involved. Right? Like, I don't know. I used to joke about it. When you first heard those things, you see something, say something. I'm like, I ain't saying nothing. We all know that saying, snitches get stitches. Like, I ain't saying nothing. But there's reality to it. Like, when you see something, I think it'd be better if you see something, do something. Because God could use you to really bless that person. And if you can't say something, because then you should let them know why you're doing it. And it's kind of strange because here when you get into verse 4, it's like another little reminder. We've heard this echoed in the book of Isaiah. What did he say? Fear not. fear not. Like I said, I don't know about you guys, but I gotta be honest, I'm afraid of a lot of things. And the things that I'm most afraid of is the things that are out of my control. And I gotta be okay with them being out of my control and just give it to God. Like we say something here and there, let go and let God, just give it to Him. But we're scared to give it to Him, right? We have fear in our hearts and it clouds our judgment. It cripples us. And I think that's why God's always reminding us, fear not, don't let it cripple you. Fear not, because I'm going to bless you. Right here it says, fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced, for you will forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. He's saying, your past is not what defines you. Right? That's the idea. Him concerning Israel at this time, they left him. And they left him because they, like, not only as they divorced him, but they pretty much just said, oh, God's dead. We might as well just be widows. And they lived in such a way where they went and they, in a sense, cheated on God with all these other deities and other nations. That's heartbreaking. God loved them. And yet, they left him. And then they didn't only leave him, but they said, well, you left us. And he's like, I never left. Right? In verse 5, it goes, for your maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts, and his name, the Holy One of Israel, is your Redeemer. The God of the whole earth, he is called. He's saying, I'm your maker. What are you talking about? I'm your husband. I never left you. If anything, I'm the one that's redeeming you. I'm the one that's rescuing you. I'm the one that's going to make sure you're okay. You know, I love you as a husband loves a wife. I would never leave you. You guys left me. And that's the sad truth, because God, like, yeah, I love that. That analogy is, I better start chasing after God. But I'm like, well, you just got to stop running away from God. God's the one chasing you. God's been chasing you since you were born. He loves you. We got to just remember that. He wanted us way before we wanted Him. Like, right? Because He loved us even while we're His enemies. He loved us first. In Hosea, great book, you guys should read it. But in Hosea chapter 2, verses 19 to 20 says, and I will betroth you to me forever. I will betroth you to me in righteousness and in justice, in steadfast love and in mercy. I will betroth you to me in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. The idea of betroth. So I'll marry you. I will promise you. I will promise to just be with you. That's this whole eternal covenant talking thing. Ready? He said, I will make you mine, to where we'll be so intertwined and so connected, people won't be able to tell us apart. That's the idea of a marriage. It's like, almost, you know, it's kind of strange. I've been married now for about 8 years, and sometimes I'll be talking to my wife, or she'll be talking to me, and you can kind of tell that we've been hanging out for a while, right? I'm like, man, that's something I would have said. Like, man, what is this? You know, people that are outside of our group, they really know. They're like, oh man, you guys are almost saying the exact same thing. It was because we're doing life together. And we kind of want to do that same thing with, I know God wants to do it. We're trying to do that with our walk with Christ. That's why we say it so often, is show our neighbors a new life in Christ. Because we want to show them that this is who we are. Yes. This is what we're about. This defines us. It's not us, but what He is doing in us. Amen? Going into verse 6 of chapter 54, it says, for the Lord has called you like a wife deserted and grieved in spirit. Like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says your God. He's saying, I'm the one making peace with you. I'm the one calling you. Did you know that you are in this church not by anything but because God called you to be here? I truly believe that in my heart. Is you could have done anything else today, and yet you chose to be here to worship God. There's something amazing about that. That He calls us to Himself. He's the one that said, "Ring, ring." I'm just kidding. Silence your phones if you guys are in the church. All right. Whenever I say ring, ring, my daughter says hello. Right? She's a one-year-old and she gets the concept. For years, God was calling me, and what was I doing? I was hitting that ignore button. I don't want to talk to him. I don't want to talk to him. I'm mad at him. I'm frustrated with him. I can't see why he would make me do this or make her, you know what I mean? I had every excuse, and I was always just putting that ignore button down. When I finally said I love you, it wasn't like, why didn't you answer the phone? It was like, I love you. I'm glad you're okay. Because he was checking, he was constantly calling us to himself. Because why? Because the church is his bride. And he says, I already called you to be a part of my church. Now you need to surrender. Now you need to do it. Isaiah 62, 4 through 5. Because we're getting back to Israel. You know, I always like wanted to show application because, hey, you know, this has got to be relevant to us. But remember, Isaiah's audience in this moment is Israel. And then I wanted to get this little chunk of scripture because in the here and now, Israel will be restored. But it's saying ultimately in the millennial kingdom, like, they will be restored. This prophecy says in 62 verses 4 through 5 of Isaiah, you shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate, but you shall be called my delight. My delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. And like I said, this is this thing where he's just using this language. Is I'm going to be right there. I don't know if you guys have been in a wedding in a while. I'm a pastor, so I get to, you know, partake in those. We were just excited about our brother Rob getting married just on the 2nd of July. I mean, there's something to be celebrated there, because not so much about what's going on, and that's great, what's going on with the woman and the man. But it's that representation of what God's going to do with this church ultimately when he comes back. Like a redeemed humanity is going to be his bride. The church is going to be his forever. And he's saying, I'm going to marry you. You're going to be mine. But like he gets back into that question. Because like what's questioning him? It's like the reason is like, well, you say that and that's all good and gone. But you know, like, The reality is where's God now? Like, where was he when I was over here and when I was going through this? Because what's going on? They just got out of captivity, right? They were there for 70 years in Babylon. They're still bitter about it. They're like, he wasn't there when I needed him. He left me. Then in verse 7 it says, for a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you, says the Lord, right? And he says, for a brief moment, I had to let you go and do your thing. I had to turn away from what you were doing because what you were doing didn't merit for me to be there because you decided to do it on your own. And I don't know if you guys have ever gone through this, maybe with a kid, or maybe you were the kid and your parent had to do it, but they had to kind of let you go and make your own mess so you learned your lesson. Like, you know, they told you a million times, don't do it. Finally, there's like, go do it. I'll be here when you get back, but I'm not going to be able to deter you from making this mistake. I just pray that it doesn't cost you more than you bargained for. Because, well, one decision can have a lifetime of consequences. But God is such a loving God that he says, but I'm not going to restrain you, but I'll be here when you get back.
Amen.
So he acknowledges that, right? He says, you guys say I desert you, but for a brief moment, I let you kind of go do what you wanted. Like, that's on you. Verse 8, it says, in overflowing anger, for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. He says, it's this moment, guys. I said, I didn't know when I turned my face, and in that moment you're going to do all this. I always joke, because I'm just like, I walked out of the room for 1 second, like, son, I'll be right back. Don't do anything. Like in that moment I turned my face, baby girl's crying, then I hear a big old crash. What did you do, right? Like, oh man. But I don't yell at my baby girl for crying. What do? I pick her up and I say, okay. You're right. I mean, she totally did what I told her not to do. Told her, don't, why are you standing on the edge of the couch? Like, that's a bad idea. Sometimes I do want to yell, you know? I was like, ah! You know, like, but in that moment, she's crying. Am I going to really yell at her and chastise her for, or am I going to show her compassion for? And love on her. And guess what God's saying? He's saying, guys, I have every right to be angry with you. I was so angry with you, I turned my face from you. He said, I looked away. He's saying, but now, I will show you compassion. I will turn to you and I'll redeem you. I'll love you. In Lamentations 3, 31 through 32, it says, for the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. There's just some sites they don't know. You know what? I'll just show you. It was a good picture, trust me. I'm just kidding. But in a steadfast love, he said that I may have had to cast you out for a minute or chastise you. Another way would say, I had to pretty much put you in timeout. Right? I had to put you in timeout, but you know what? I still love you. I still will do anything and everything for you. And my steadfast love, you know what? It's not only there, but it's abundantly there. And we'll get this screen fixed. I can see it behind me flickering. Sorry about that. But when I read that verse, it reminded me of 1 Corinthians 13:13. It says, so now faith, hope, and love abide these three, but the greatest of these is what?
Love.
Like, I mean, I hear scripture just tell me sometimes some like hard things to swallow, right? I mean, when I read that God cast him off, like God was the one that said, go. Like, that hurts, because I'm like, man, why would he do that? But then you got to remember, God is a father. He's a loving father at that, where he's saying, I need you to know better. I need you to do better, so that way you can be better. Like, you know, I don't think he ever does anything just flippantly, right? He has a plan. He has a purpose for it. For Israel, you know, they got chastised pretty good. In 70 years in captivity. I mean, I feel bad about putting my kid in timeout for 2 minutes. You know, like, you know, 70 years. But he says, it's because I love you I did this. Because I love you and I want more for you. And then he's reminding him, and I promise that I'll always have compassion on you. I promise that I will love you. I mean, it goes into verse 9. Alluding to the promise he made of Noah. Right? He says, this is like the days of Noah to me, as I swore that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth. So I have sworn that I will not be angry with you and will not rebuke you. I don't know if you guys remember that story. But Noah, you know, comes out of the ark with his family, with the animals. And he's just, probably all of us would be thinking, like, was he going to do this again? Like, I'd be a little worried about procreating and having more kids if all of a sudden, like, hey, are you going to get angry again and punish the whole world again? And God knows in his heart, he says, I will never again flood the earth as I did. We just give him a disclaimer. He says, next time it's going to be fire. But I'm going to destroy sin forever. But he's saying, I love you. And that's why I did this, because I need better of you. I mean, we don't know the exact number of people that were on the earth when the flood happened. But I've heard some theologians and some scholars estimate, millions, maybe a billion. And 8 people got on that ship. I mean, that shows God is serious about sin. You know, but he knew it broke his heart more than it broke anyone else's. He said, I'll never do that again. I'll never chastise you that way again. It's like that idea, to kind of bring it back, to 2023. It's like when you smack your kid on the bottom and he's crying, you might have to punish him again, but you're like, I'll never punish you like that again. I may have hit you a little too hard on that butt. Right? Because parents probably, when you might have been like, okay, that was a little bit much. I'm sorry. They look at you and they're just like all sad. You're like, oh man. Don't tell your mom. No, I'm kidding. but you know the idea. You're like, I'll never do it like that again. I'm so sorry. Because I meant to teach you a lesson. And I think the lesson was taught, so I don't think I'd rather teach it again. Because now everybody will know because of what you went through. Chapter 39, verses 28 and 29, it says, then they shall know that I am the Lord their God, because I sent them into exile among the nations, and then assembled them into their own land. I will leave none of them remaining among the nations anymore, and I will not hide my face anymore from them. When I pour out my spirit upon the house of Israel, declares the Lord God. He's saying, I'm not going to hide from you no longer. I'm not going to turn away from you. I'm going to look at you. Which is crazy. He sends Jesus. Not only did he say, I'm not going to hide from you, he reveals himself in the incarnate Jesus Christ. He comes and walks amongst them. Going into verse 10, it says, for the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you. O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony, antimony, and lay your foundations with sapphires. I will make your pinnacles of agate, your gates of carbuncles, and all your wall of precious stones. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. He's saying, guys, it's going to be amazing when we get there. But it's going to take time to get there. Like, it doesn't happen overnight. The pruning process sucks. Right? God's going to might be pruning some things out of your life, and he's going to have to lop some things off that's going to hurt. But you will grow better. You will be better. In John 6, verses 44 and 45, it says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. That's Jesus saying, God's going to bring you to him. God's going to bring you to himself. Like, as much as we do everything we can to get you guys in here to worship, it is God that's going to do the transforming. It is God that's going to do it. It is not us. And even in these last verses, it says, in the righteousness you shall be established, you shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near you. If anyone stirs up strife, it is not from me. Whoever stirs up strife with you shall fall because of you. Behold, I have created the smith who blows the fire of coals and produces a weapon. For its purpose I have also created the ravager to destroy. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed. And you shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I don't know if you guys love poems. I love poems. But like that, no weapon formed shall prosper against me. I've heard that verse a million times. And I was almost going to just preach on that verse alone. I was like, let me just talk about that one. But instead, I just figured I'm going to let this poem be read to you guys. And then we're going to have the worship team come up and sing us our last song. So if you guys would open your ears. This is called No Weapon Formed Shall Prosper Against Me. It was written by Walter T. Ashe. When the slings and arrows and a torrent come my way, when the sticks and stones are used on the same day, I know who stands with me, ensuring victory. For no weapon formed shall prosper against me. If I must stand alone against 10,000 men, I will stand my ground and shout, bring it then. Do not do what must be done, but know this clearly. No weapon formed shall prosper against me. If it comes with fire, I will douse it with rain. Whenever it attacks, it'll be defeated again. It'll never know the sweet taste of victory, for no weapon formed shall prosper against me. Bravery and courage on life's battlefield requires knowing when to battle and when to yield. Though I walk through the shadow of Death Valley, no weapon formed shall prosper against me. He who stands with me has a double-edged sword. He's a warrior God who is named the Lord. Omnipotent is he, and I courageously decree that no weapon formed shall prosper against me. Amen, guys. God bless you.
Okay, if I could have everybody stand up, please. We'll close out in prayer. Just want to thank everybody. Part of the fruits, spiritual fruits, it's becoming physical with the sanctuary getting more brothers and sisters here. Who's redeemed?
Amen.
I don't see all the hands up. I remember what Jesus Christ did, and that debt can't be even paid. And it's just amazing to see the fruits of the works. So with that, dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for my brothers and sisters here. Thank you for the word Pastor Duran prepared for us. And thank you for saving us. And saving us from ourselves most of the time. But also saving us from the enemy and protecting us. A poor blessing on my brothers and sisters through the Holy Spirit. I pray that they go forth and not be ashamed, but to proclaim the good news wherever they go. Whatever darkness they encounter, that they may see somebody that's in that darkness, for them to have the courage and the strength to pull them out. Because the strength comes through you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Amen.
So some people say that God's phone number is Jeremiah 33:3 reads, call to me and I will answer you, and tell you what great and hidden things that you have not known. God assured Jeremiah that he only needed to call out to God and God would answer. God is ready to answer our prayers, but we must come to him. We do not always see what God is doing behind the scenes in our lives, but he calls us to trust him and to wait expectantly for him to tell us the most amazing and mighty things that we don't yet know or even comprehend. God is patiently waiting for your call every day, so call on him now. Call out the Lord, for he is listening. Today is the day of salvation. Don't wait. Tomorrow isn't a promise to us, but forgiveness is. New life is. So during this last song, join us in praising the Lord for his awesomeness, his mercy, his love. Sing out, church. Let go and let God worship with us. Let's sing, let's pray, let's thank the Lord for all he has done and all he is doing and all he will do. During
During this time, if you want to come up and get prayer or stay and worship, please do so. Thank you.
They say after the first 8 miles.